Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to Shofar Utrecht. I'd like to just read a bit out of scripture for us and then pray. And in the meantime, since we're going to be starting with worship, it would be nice if you guys can rise to your feet. It's easier to worship while standing. So I'm reading out of Psalms 104 from verse 31. May the glory of the Lord endure forever. May the Lord rejoice in his works. He who looks at the earth and it trembles, who touches the mountains and they smoke. I will sing to the Lord all my life. I will sing praise to my God as long as I live. May my meditation be pleasing to him as I rejoice in the Lord. And Father God, we come before you as a congregation and we surrender before you. We open our hearts. We pray that you would come join us among our ranks, Lord, and come minister to us and come help us to hear your heart, to hear your voice, and to experience your love for us. And thank you, Lord, for this privilege. In Jesus' name, come receive the praises that are due. Amen.
We were So the sound comes. Welcome all, so many people, it's amazing. Temperatures are rising. I spotted the first South African wearing a t-shirt, so then we know it's getting warmer. I like to invite you to turn to your neighbor, welcome each other in God's house, introduce yourself if you never did. Nice. So I'm wondering if we have new visitors today. If you are here for the first time, would you like to raise your hand so we know you're new? And welcome. In back. We're so happy you came. There will be a little paper on the card. You can fill it in. We won't spam you or anything. And if you like, you can hand it to me after the service. And we're happy to get to know you. Welcome. And that's pretty cool. I hope their calendars are sharper. I'd like to talk about the Children's Church today with, where are you? Oh, yeah, Roelien. Nah, I know you so long and I forgot your name. Sorry. And we'll be with Roelien. If you have children 0 to 3 years old in the townzaal, you can see the surface still, but the children can be loud, and you can still not miss the surface. Next point is the intercession meeting. Maybe you know we have before the service, 2:15, intercession meetings. Today was so cool, so many people joined, and it's so beautiful to pray for the service. We really need God's help to build this church, and cannot do it alone. In Monday, by Derek and Renee, there will be the intercession from 7 till 8. And if you're lucky, you can even get dinner if you tell them in time. So, doesn't want that. Pannenkoeken. And something else what brings community together is our small groups, where we go even further and deeper in conversations together after. In the evenings, it depends on which group you connect yourself. If you're not connected to a small group and you're new in this church, or you're doubting, I want to take your doubts away and say you should go, because it's so encouraging to meet other people and be together there. If you have more questions, Urbanus will be happy to answer your questions, or anything, anybody else who looks like he knows or she knows, you can always come, and you can register online. An encounter part 2 is coming soon, May 6th, and you can sign up online. This will be focusing on the home aspect of this church, where we'll be explained what a church stands for, what we believe. If you're new, or you want to make Shofar your home church, we invite you to come and get to know more about Shofar, but also more general living your life as a Christian. So that's really cool to be a part of. It's a whole day from 10 o'clock in the apartment of Derek Jan and René, the pastor, couple of this church, and you can sign up in the back or online. So before I share that we have coffee, which everybody knows, I want to share a little testimony. God really put it on my heart to share this real, I want to be real quick. as some of you know, I'm a photographer for my daily job, and I'm almost crying because God is so good. And he has spoke to me to super practical that my camera would break. And my amazing girlfriend will know that's true, because we talked about it last week, and I was thinking, is this God, or am I making this up myself? We all have that sometimes, when God speaks to us, we sometimes think it's ourselves or whatever. So the stupid I am sometimes, I just ignored it a little bit, and I thought it was God, but I was like, it won't be so bad, you know. So yesterday, Friday, the day before yesterday, I had a wedding to photograph. It was an amazing wedding in the castle, super cool. But while we were doing the family photos, my camera broke. And it broke so bad that I couldn't fix it anymore. It's those things happen. But the point is that God really speaks, and it broke, and I was like, oh, ships, what am I gonna do now? But I was more thinking like, wow, God, you really speak through your Holy Spirit, and you really, that was for me just such a moment of thankfulness that God just does speak and that he is alive. And the moment was kind of perfect that it broke. And everything, I have a backup, so everything went well, but this is so cool to me that God just really speaks to us, and that we, as I speak for myself, sometimes are ignorant, and I think we can do it ourselves or don't need his advice. And this is so cool. So I wanted to have this opportunity to share and encourage you when you sometimes don't feel like God is speaking, or if you're not hearing God, or what to do. He really does speak, and for myself it was just an amazing eye opener. So be encouraged. Coffee and tea in the back after, for those who don't know. And yeah, be welcome to get in touch with us, and then Bem will come and share.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Bem Evaristo, and I am here to deliver today's offering message. Today's message is taken from the book of Psalms, chapter 46, verse 10. He says, "Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth." On the surface, this psalm reads like a little bit too removed from the purpose with which I stand here today, which is to deliver the offering message. But as I meditated on this verse, turns out this psalm may be as relevant an offering message as any other. You see, today, in today's world, the phrase "be still" becomes even more relevant when we consider our generation's preoccupation with social media and all the various distractions that take our focus away from meditating on God's Word. It seems like we're always connected, we're always scrolling, and we're always consuming information. And I would suggest, I suppose you will agree, or you can agree, that this constant stimulation leaves little room, if any, for God to speak to us, for quiet reflection and prayer. When viewed this way, I would suggest that the phrase "be still" is a gentle but powerful reminder for us to step back from the noise and all the distractions of our digital age, and also to make a conscious effort to connect with God on a more intimate and a more personal level. In other words, by learning to be still, we sort of create some space in our hearts and minds for God to better discern God's will in our lives. Also, being still is rooted in the concepts of surrender, trust, and recognizing the sovereignty of God in our lives. Psalm 46:10, therefore, is a call. It is a call to pause, a call to reflect, and a call to understand that we are not in control, but God is. So when we offer our time, our resources, our talents to God, what we're doing essentially is we're submitting ourselves to God, we're surrendering to His authority, and we're acknowledging that all we have is a gift from God. Our act of giving, I also would suggest, is not only a sort of expression of gratitude, although it is, but it's also an affirmation of our trust in God, in God's provision and His care. So the connection between Psalm 46:10 and our offering of our time, resources, and talents to God can be viewed in two ways. One, as an act of creating space for Him to speak to us, and two, as an act of, or as a recognition of God's sovereignty, an act of surrender and an expression of trust in His provision. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank You for Your loving presence in our lives. As we meditate on Psalm 46:10, help us to remember the importance of being still and quieting our hearts in Your presence. In the midst of our fast-paced lives and constant distractions, teach us, remind us to prioritize our relationship with You, to seek Your wisdom and guidance above all else. Lord, as we offer our time, our resources, our talents, may our hearts be aligned with Your will and Your purpose. We ask that you would use our gifts for the advancement of your kingdom and for the transformation of lives. Help us to always trust in your provision and care, and to know that you are our ultimate source of strength and our only source of security. As we learn to be still, may we be a reflection of your grace and mercy to every single soul around us. And may our acts of generosity be a testimony to your goodness. In all things we give you thanks, honor, and praise, because you are our God, and you're exalted among the nations and in all the earth. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. To those of you who are in the church for the first time, you are not obliged to give. To those who want to give, we don't pass around offering basket anymore. We have several modes with which you can give your offering. There's a QR code at the info table at the back after the service. Their bank details also are available at the Shofar Utrecht website. And if you want to offer your time and serve as a volunteer, you will also find all the information at the info table at the back after the service. Enjoy the rest of the worship.
Thank you.
garbage that's taken outside of the city, Lord. You were taken to Golgotha and disposed of, Lord. And you were the rejected one. That's what we thought of you. You were the garbage that we wanted to get rid of. And yet you were raised above all others, Lord. Your name was exalted above every other name. Thank you, Lord, that you know humility, that you know how it feels like to be down there, Lord, because the last will be first and the first will be last, Father. Head, a crown of thorns upon.
raise up these children as children of yours, that they can go out as ambassadors, whatever they are and as small as they are, that they will learn what it is to have a relationship with you. And so, Father, I speak a blessing over today's classes. I speak a blessing over Arlene, and I pray, Lord, that the Holy Spirit is going to speak through her, Father. And I pray, Lord, that these young hearts are going to absorb what is going to be said today, that it can make a difference in their lives as what they go as children of yours. In Jesus' name, amen. I need it. Good afternoon to all of you, and I trust you had an awesome week. Me and Renee had an awesome week. It was the 8th time that we became grandparents, so we've got 8 grandchildren now. And we're very proud on it, and we're looking forward. They're going to come and visit all of us at the end of June. So then, I won't say the church is then immediately full, but it will be quite a few of them. It's awesome. I asked God and I said, but where are we going to talk about today? And I felt that the Lord said, my word, his word. And it's so easy, because if I'm going to ask you, how does God speak to us? Then most of the time we immediately will say, well, God speak to us through the Bible. And there's nothing wrong with it. God is speaking more than just through the Bible. And this afternoon, I feel that God wants to take us a little bit deeper of what it actually means, that if we are going to have a look at the Word and what it means to listen to God's Word, but also the different words that we've got concerning the Bible. Before we're going to carry on, let's first pray. Thank you, Father. Thank you that you are always available, and it's a matter of us that we've got to come to you. And we've got an appointment with you this afternoon, Father. An appointment that you want to speak to us. And Father, I pray, Lord, that whatever kept us busy earlier today, or even on the way over here, or maybe this week, that we can set it aside, and that we can listen to what you want to share with us today. And if the enemy wants to distract us, Father, then we're also using the authority what we've got in the name of Jesus Christ, and we bind the powers of the enemy so that he's not going to disturb the sermon this afternoon, that we can hear what you want to share with us this afternoon, Father. We thank you that we can come and that we can become quiet. As what's been mentioned just now, that we can become still, and in our busy life, that we can set time aside for you to listen what you want to share with us. Thank you that you are a perfect Father, and that we can be children of yours through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Coming back again to words, that words can sometimes be confusing as well. I remember one time we had a conversation around our table, and we had a few people sitting around our table from different countries, which is, of course, it's happening quite a lot at our house. And then somebody mentioned a certain name of a certain thing, and it was gown. And it was 3 different meanings what we got. The one thought, it is a type of a bathrobe, a type of a dressing gown would you wear. And the other thought that it was a lady's dress, an evening dress. And the other one thought it was a gun. So it just gives you a little bit of an example of how easy it is that words are confusing, because we do not really know what a word actually means or what the other person is saying. And then with us, what God's word is concerned, we've got a privilege that we can go back and we can have a look and we can say, but okay, what is written in the Hebrew, or what is written in the Greek? Where does the word coming from? And we can look at the comments and we can do a little bit of study, and then we say, but oh, wait a moment, now it actually means much more, and it is different as what I initially thought. one word which is very known to all of you, and I think it is, many people have been preaching about it as well, is the word love. The word love, where we've got four different meanings. Now, in English, the word love is one word, and immediately, if we think about love, we think a little bit about Hollywood, that type of thing. But it's not correct. If we take a look at the word love in the Bible, and we take a look at it, we see that the one is a filial, a strong friendship. The other one is a storge, a family relationship. And the other one is the agape, the selfless, unconditional love, the love that God has got for us. The fourth one, the eros, is actually not mentioned in the Bible. But that's the one which we normally, and which in the world, is seen as the word love. So today as well, I felt that we've got to have a look at words in the Bible which are actually saying, this is my word, this is my scripture. And the words, what we find over there are three words, graphe, logos, and rhema, where all three of them are referring to God's word, or referring to the word of God. The first one is graphe, which means scripture. I'm not going to spend too much time on that one, because the examples what we've got in the Bible is referring that it is translated as scripture. 2 Timothy 3, verses 16 and 17, where Paul is speaking, and he says, all scriptures, all words are given by inspiration of God. All graphe is given by the inspiration of God. And it's profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. The word over there refers then to the scriptures. Now, if Paul is speaking then to Timothy about scriptures, the only scriptures what they had at that time was the Old Testament. So he's talking about the Old Testament. But we also can see later on, when we take a look at the Bible and we take a look at scripture, we include the New Testament into as well. But also that's not the word what I would like to talk about this afternoon. The one what I would like to talk about is the two words logos and rhema. And if we take a look at logos and rhema, and I've got to repent, I googled a little bit to have a look and see what type of comments are available on the words logos and rhema. Then there are, and I've got to say it with respect, that there are churches who say, but the logos and the rhema is exactly the same. It's exactly the same. There's no difference in it. It's interchangeable. You can use it, the one or the other one. But I'm going to try and show to you that there is a difference, and that's for sure a difference, and there's an important difference between the logos and the rhema. The logos doesn't refer to Lego, the small blocks. It's logos, it means the words, the word of God. Just want to make sure that we're all on the same page over there. And then it says in the New Testament, the logos is used to refer to the constant written word which is recorded in the Bible. So the easy explanation what logos is concerned would be, it's the written word. It's the word which has been written down, where God told the people what has got to be written down. And when we read the written word, we can learn from who God is, what his ways are, what his salvation is, and what his plans are for mankind. And that's an awesome thing if we take a look at it, that God gave us the Bible, that awesome word, that we can go back to it, and then we can look it up again, and that we can continuously read that God prepared this for us, his word. It's not a matter of that we say, okay, but wait a moment, what did that person say again? Or you've got to phone him again, and you've got to ask him, but you can read it up yourself. And we are privileged that God gave us a book like this. And then you can say, yeah, the thing has been written so many years back, and it's an old book. No. Current. It's each and every day of our lives. We can use it. Matthew 24, verse 35. Heaven and earth may pass away, but my words, my logos, my written word will by no means pass away. And my words, what Jesus is also saying over there, it will never be vain and empty. It will never be unaccomplished. That is the logos. The second word what I would like to have a look at is the rhema. And the rhema is the spoken word of God, The Logos is the written word, and where, to make it very easy, the Rhema is the spoken word of God. And Rhema will be our general term to refer to all of these means of God communicating his specific will to an individual. First scripture what I want to read over there is the one from Matthew 4, verses 4. But he answered and he said, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God." Every word, and the Greek word over there is rhema, the spoken word of God. We shall not live by bread alone, which means if we are living from bread, then we are taking bread each and every day. And it's necessary that we must take God's word each and every day. But also that it's not only the written word, but also the spoken word of God. Every word what proceeds from the mouth of God. Continuously we've got to listen what God is saying to us. We had a perfect example just now, as what Albert said. His ears were open to hear what God was saying to him. And thank you for that small sermon over there. We've got to do that. We've got to be continuously open what God wants to speak to us, because he wants to speak to us. Yes, he has spoken to us through the word, the written word, but he also wants to speak to us with the rhema, the word what he continuously brings to us, and that we can act on that. And what we will see just now, how important it is what we must do that. Luke 5, verses 5 also talks about the rhema. But Simon answered and said to him, "Master, we have toiled all night and caught nothing. Nevertheless, at your word, I will let down the net." It wasn't a matter of that Simon was fishing over there. He didn't catch anything. But he took the Bible and he said, "Okay, let's have a look what God is saying to me. What must I do? Because I didn't catch anything." But he listened to what Jesus said to him. Jesus said, "Put your net on the other side." And he was obedient. He was obedient to what God to him said. And he put the net on the other side. And he caught a lot of fish. Rhema is the spoken word. And Logos, it is then the written word. So we've got to live from that Rhema word. We also have got to listen to that word. But it can also be that the Rhema word is sometimes a revelation. You maybe read Psalm 23, "The Lord is my shepherd." And as you read it and as you ponder on it, you actually mean what God is, you understand what God is saying over there. And God is revealing himself over there. That's also what's called Rhema, what God is revealing himself to us through his word. And we need the written word, the Logos, for our foundation. But we also need the spoken word, the Rhema, for direction. And both of them are crucial in our lives. Both of them, we need them in our lives. Because God uses the Logo words to speak his Rhema to us. And God living instead of speaking allows or always corresponds with and never contradicts his word. That's the other thing. The written word and the spoken word of God is never contradicting each other. We'll get to that one a little bit later as well. And sometimes the people are taking the word which is written over there and they basically translate it incorrectly. I'm going to take Ephesians 6 verse 17, the spiritual armor, and then it says, "And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God." And quite easily we say, okay, the word of God, that's then the Bible. So it's the word of God which is our sword. No. The word over there is Rhema. Spoken word of God is our sword. That what God speaks to us, what he is saying to us, how we've got to act at that specific time. That is our sword. Not to say that the Bible is wrong, but if we take a look at the translation of what has been written over there, then it says it's the Rhema word, the spoken word of God, which is the sword of the Spirit. So God's word includes both the Logos and the Rhema. The Logos is then the written word, and the Rhema is the revelation, the spoken word for us in a specific situation. But God speaks to us on other ways as well, and all different ways of how God is speaking to us. The first one I want to talk about is hearing God's voice. And those of you who attended Encounter One yesterday, if it is correct, my wife should have spoken about hearing God's voice a little bit, she said. She didn't spend too much time on it. The scripture which is on the schedule to be used is John 10, verses 27. My sheep hear my voice, I know them, and they follow me. My sheep, Jesus is saying over there, you belong to me, you're part of me. My sheep hear my voice. They are hearing God's voice. They are hearing what God is saying over there. And I know them, and they follow me. And if they are hearing God's voice, then they are recognizing God's voice. They can say, but it's God speaking to me. But they also understand what God is speaking to them. And God spoke to Albert and says about your camera, which is going to break. Immediately he knew, because it was on his wavelength. He's a cameraman. He knows exactly what a camera is and all those type of things. And sometimes if we do not understand it, then we can ask God again to just clarify, or what is he actually meaning over there? And this is crucial, that we understand it, that God wants to speak to us. Another way of that people are speaking to us is spoken, that word spoken to us by somebody else as a prophecy. And a prophecy is, in the Bible we see sometimes, thus says the Lord. And then we think, and then we start shaking if somebody says something like that to us. But fortunately, we're not doing it. We're doing it a little bit soft, and we say, I hear God saying. And then we share what we feel that God is saying to us. And then we prophesy over other people. But a prophecy must always be tested and must always be weighted. 1 Thessalonians 5, verses 19 to 21. Do not quench the spirit, which means that you are going to, cut yourself off, or close yourself off, or as Ben was saying, that we don't make time, that we are not still, because we're busy with our things, we actually cannot hear God. We mustn't quench the Holy Spirit, and we mustn't despise the prophecies. And prophecies is something where people are a little bit hesitant about. They say, oh, that sounds a little bit spooky if somebody else is going to prophesy over me. Paul is saying over here, do not despise prophecy. Test all things and hold fast what is good. Sometimes people are prophesying to their own hearts. They're saying to you what they think you actually want to hear. Or they're saying to you what they think is good for the situation. We can read it in Jeremiah and in Ezekiel, but I'll read the scripture out of Jeremiah 23. Thus says the Lord of hosts, do not listen to the words of the prophets who prophesy to you. They make you worthless. They speak a vision of their own heart. They're not listening to what God is saying to them. They're basically cut off the communication with God, and they're just saying what they think is correct to say at that moment. They speak a vision of their own heart, not from the mouth of the Lord. And Ezekiel is also talking about it, where he says that those prophets who follow their own spirit and have nothing. But we must test the prophecies, if people are speaking prophecies to us. And the way of doing this is that we first have got to pray, and we've got to ask God, is this what has been said to me? Is this correct, or is it not correct? And if you're still not sure about it, then you can ask friends to pray for you. But don't tell them what God told you. Let them first pray and see if they are confirming what you heard from God as well. Because you at the final end are going to be responsible how you react to those prophecies. And if those prophecies, if you feel that they are not applicable to you, cut them off, leave them. Do not spend further time on it. And be very careful with prophecies, because sometimes prophecies can create an action from another person which is actually not godly. And then a person is doing a thing, and then afterward finding out, but wait a moment, it wasn't actually God's will. But I thought that person with that status, if he prophesies over me, then it must be from God, I must do it. No. You still have got to check with God. Lord, is this one for me or is this one not for me? Prophecy is very important. If we take a look at the gifts of the Father, the gifts of the Son, and the gifts of the Holy Spirit, prophecy is the only gift which we will find in all three of them. In the Father, which is the redemptive gifts, the Son, which is the fivefold ministries, and then the gifts of the Holy Spirit as well. We've got a little bit of a small test, and I've got it in digital format, and if you say you want to do that test to find out if prophecy is one of your gifts, what God has given to you, then you can send me a WhatsApp and I will send that information through to you. And if you do not know where my number is, please take a look at that pen at the bottom. That's my number. But I also did that test and I had a look at, okay, Lord, what are my gifts? What are you giving to me? What are my redemptive gifts? Prophecy was my second one. I never knew it and I never operated in it because I wasn't aware of it. But once through that test, I became aware that this is what God has given to me. I started moving in it, and it was very easy for me actually to start moving in it because I knew this is what God has given to me and he wants me that I should operate in it. It's not my first gift. My first gift is a teacher, but the second one is then a prophecy. And then it makes it so much easier if we know what God wants to give to us and how we should make a difference in other people's life. God's word is important to us. And God's word, we basically can put it in the words what we've spoken to about just now. God's word, the Logos, the Rhema, his voice, and his prophecies were there to make a change in our lives. If we're hearing or if we're reading the Bible, and if we're listening to God's word, and if we're listening to his voice, and if we're listening to what the prophecies are saying to us, and nothing is changing, then why are we doing it? But it must make a change. We must continuously move where God wants us, where we should go, and what we should do. The Bible is maybe not saying to you, you've got to start working in Utrecht at that company or anything like that. That's not in the Bible. Utrecht is not in the Bible. It's long ago before that. But if somebody gives you a prophecy and says, I feel God is saying to you, you've got to work in Utrecht, you've got to work at that place, then you can pray about it and you can ask God and say, God, is this for me? And then you can act accordingly. And then it makes a change in our lives because we're continuously busy with changing. And we can only change if we get input and if we react on it. And a word of God is important in that way that it is valuable because it will never return to him void. I'm going to read Isaiah 55 because the whole chapter is actually beautiful, but I only have got 11 on the screen. But if we take a look at how it starts, where God says, I'm giving an invitation to an abundant life for you. And then he says, everyone who thirsts, come to waters. And you who have no money, come buy and eat. Yes, come buy wine and milk without money and without price. What an invitation it is from the creator of heaven and earth who says, come. And he says it over there 3 times. Come, come, come. Why do you spend money for what is not bread and your wages for what does not satisfy? Listen carefully to me and eat what is good and let your soul delight itself in abundance. Incline my ear and come to me. Hear and your soul shall live. We've got to hear. We've got to become quiet and listen to what God is sharing with us. And I will make an everlasting covenant with you and the sure mercies of David. Indeed, I have given him a witness to the people, a leader and commander for the people. Surely you shall call a nation you do not know, a nation who do not know you shall run to you. And he's referring to those who are going to come and conquer them because of the Lord your God and the Holy One of Israel, for he has glorified you. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Become quiet. Seek the Lord when he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way And the unrighteous man, his thoughts, let him return to the Lord, and he will have mercy on him. God is waiting for the unrighteous people. He's waiting that they should come back to him. And to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. And then a beautiful part, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as heaven are higher than earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as rain come down and as snow from heaven, and do not return there, but water the earth, and make it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater. God is giving water. It's coming from him down. He's giving it to us that we can receive and that the seed can bud and that there will be bread. And so shall be my word that goes forth from my mouth. It shall not return to my void, but it shall accomplish what I please, and it shall prosper in the things for what I've sent it. And that is the Rhema word, what God is giving to us. He's speaking to us. And that word is not going to return empty. It's going to make changes in our lives. But we've got to be open for that word. We've got to be prepared to listen to it. And a lot of times we haven't got time. Like Ben also said, we've got other things which are keeping us busy. And I'm pleading guilty over there as well. You've got to set time aside, that you become quiet, that you read his word, but that you also allow that God is speaking to you, and that you can bring things in your life, that you can bring it to him, and that you can ask him and say, Lord, Father, how do you want me that I should react? What must I do? You can pray for other people whom God is putting on your heart. If we're just going to focus on the Logos, on a written, we're never going to hear what God wants us that we should do. We've got to be open for the other as well, for the Rhema, for his voice, and for the prophecies, that we can hear what God wants to share with us. We're going to do a little bit of a different thing today. I'm asking the band to come. They're going to play the last song, but I'm going to challenge you a little bit this afternoon. It's going to be a little bit of a different service today. When they're going to play the song and when we're going to sing, I'm going to ask you to ask God to give you a prophecy for somebody else in the church. Ooh, yes. Maybe a little bit strange, but I really feel that God is asking that we should do that we should practice that. Because if it's in the Word, if it's all the gifts have got it in it, if Paul is saying that we should not neglect the prophecies, then we should practice it as well. And fortunately, we are not such a big church, so we can, I would say, quite easily do it. So I'm going to ask the band to play that song. And then in that song, as we are busy with singing, ask God, look around, and say, Lord, is there anyone for whom you've got a prophecy, for whom you've got a word, what you want to speak through me? And then we're going to give time that you can share it with the other person. I'm going to, after this song as well, we're going to stop the streaming, but I think the streaming is not working today, so anyway, it doesn't matter. There are no people outside who are having a look at it at the moment, so don't worry about it. But if we just practice it, if we get used to it, that we listen to God, that we can edify the church, that we can hear what God wants to share to us for the other people. Thank you. Thank you. And what we actually have been doing now is taking some time, becoming quiet, listen to what God wants to say to us, to somebody else, and God speaks. Why can't we do it more often? Before going to work, say, Lord, is there anyone for whom you've got a word? And if you do exercises, you get muscles. And if you practice this, it's going to come automatically. That you get words for other people, and that you can say, this is what God is sharing with me. This is what I'm giving to you. And this is what prophecy is. And this is how God wants to work through us to other people, and that we can be used for it. A little bit of an awkward thing would be done to you today, but I think you've practiced it a little bit and you understood it, and you can understand it, how it is actually going. I would like to finish off with a prayer. Then I'm going to ask Wimpy and the band to sing the last song once again. And if any of those testimonies which have been mentioned just now of the prophecies, and you say, but what you've mentioned there for a specific person or whatever, like Albert Francis, he's talking about a lady who didn't see, but there's maybe one over here who says, but wait a moment, that's actually for me, because what he mentioned over there is exactly for me. Then go to him, and the same with the others as well. And if there's for anything else would you need prayer, I'm going to ask of the small group leaders that we can maybe have for male and female, that we can have prayer stations over there, that you can get prayer if needed, and then we can have our coffee and tea afterwards. Let's pray. Father, we come to you. You're waiting for us. You want to use us. You want to speak into our lives. You want to give us that rhema word, which we can use, which can flow through us, Father. Father, we want to be used to edify the church, to make a difference in the people's lives around us, Father. You want to use us. You want to work through us. Thank you, Father, that you've given the opportunity for people to hear, and that they could share it as well. And Father, as all the eyes are closed, if you maybe hear this afternoon and you say, but I'm battling with that one. I'm battling with that one with hearing God's voice. Then I'm going to ask you to prophetically pull out the plug out of your ear. All the eyes are closed, so people are not looking around. If you hear and you say, but I'm battling to hear God's voice, my spiritual ears are closed. Prophetically, pull the plugs out of your ears, that your spiritual ears can open up, and that you can hear what God wants to share with you. God is a Father who wants to speak to us. There are things in our lives which are blocking it. Most of the time, it's us. And Father, I pray that we're going to make time to listen to you and say, Lord, use me. Use me to make a difference in other people's lives. Give me a prophecy for somebody else. Give me a word of knowledge for somebody else. Tell me through the Spirit if I've got to pray for healing for somebody else, that I can be used for your kingdom. In the name of Jesus Christ.
Nothing in this world will do.
Thank you that you are, it's all about you, Lord. And thank you that today we could receive more from you and worship you and fellowship together as well. Bless us in this week, Lord, that what you have imparted to us today would